My name is Lina Roessler. The film is Bestsellers. Bestsellers is about a cranky old author who has one book left in him, that is, and then a young publisher who's needs one last book to save her publishing house. They come together on a crazy road trip, and together they discover a little bit more about themselves and perhaps that some things are more important than others. So.
Starting with our cantankerous author, can you talk about the perfect fit that Sir Michael Caine is for that role?
Michael is absolutely fabulous in this role, as is expected, and you couldn't ask for anything more. He really delved deep into the character and gave a lot of little subtle, the only things that Michael can do to really bring a depth to this character and an authenticity. I think what's unique about it is that we get to see him really sort of down and out. He has done that. I mean, look, he's had a brilliant career with many different roles, but this one you really get to see him vulnerable, down and out, alcohol, sort of really, and he has played that before, Educating Rita, but you get to see a sort of darker, messier side, but also with a real heart that that the man himself has as well. And Aubrey, again, is also exceptionally talented and more known for her comedic ability. But what was great for her in this role is that she really, again, brings like an authentic, emotional, subtle and sensitive character to the role of Lucy. And I think that's something we haven't seen a lot from Aubrey, so it was great. Yeah, I guess, I mean, it has been done in Lost in Translation. It's a good example, but I think what you're really talking about is men who are older and in a later stage of their lives, and then a younger woman. But what this story, at least in Bestsellers, it's, I call it a surrogate father-daughter love story. You know, they're not father-daughter, there's no romance in the story, but they become real kindred spirits, and I think that just shows that that's possible between obvious men and women, no matter what the age, and more to that, it's possible for everyone, really. I mean, we're all human, right? That's what brings us together.
We're here at Raindance, you're opening the festival. What does it mean for you to be a part of this celebration of independent storytelling?
It's really wonderful. It's a dream come true, and Michael receiving this award tonight as well, I think it's a really beautiful moment for us, for the film. Especially after COVID, it's a long time, it feels really great to come here and thank the festival very much for having us.
Of course, over the past couple of years, everyone has been asking themselves big questions, and a common one is why storytelling matters so much in our lives. Can you talk a little bit about what for you it means to be a storyteller and why stories are so important for you?
Absolutely. I think stories are important to us all, and it's how we make sense of ourselves, how we make sense of our place in the world, and how we put things together. They're just spokes in a wheel. We stitch it all together to try to find meaning in our lives, especially in times like this where, you know, the floor gives way underneath us. We don't know what's solid. We look to stories to kind of bring us together to find a meaning, and that's the point of life, right? Find a meaning in the meaning of it.
Are there any other stories that you are excited to be bringing in our direction looking to the future?
Absolutely. There are a few things on my plate, and we'll see which one gets cooked up and ready to serve first. So keep watching. I'll keep you posted.
Why do festivals like this and why does independent cinema matter so much, do you think?
Because we are reevaluating what is cinema and what is television. And we're very much focused on television, and television has got a little bit more cinematic. So we have to think again, what stories are we telling that we can tell in a cinematic format? And I think that's a good time to focus. You know, the world's changed a lot in the last 2-3 years. Apart from COVID, there are so many global things happening. What stories are we telling now?
Obviously, one of the series that has really been a good benchmark for how amazing and uplifting television can be is one you're involved with in Ted Lasso. Can you talk a little bit about why you think that series has meant so much to so many people?
I think it's pulled people out of a difficult place in the last almost 2 years it is now. I mean, it wasn't written with that in mind, because it was written and filmed and completed before we knew what COVID was. But it seems to have helped people. It's been a kind of balm and a kind of bandage for people to, you know, who have been isolated and wanted warmth and human contact. It's been a great show for that.
It's been a great journey, particularly for Higgins, your character. Can you talk a little bit about the evolution he went from in season one and two? Because I think it was a more pure version of him that we saw in the second season.
Well, that's right. He was really compromised in the first season. He couldn't be the Higgins that he was at home. You know, he couldn't bring that to the workplace because he was treading on eggshells around his, you know, very tough boss who had a vendetta. So, but that's reevaluated itself in the second season and may change again for the third. I've yet to see the script, so I don't know.
Like fans, you haven't seen anything for the third season yet. Do you have things that you'd personally like to see, not just for the series overall, but particularly for your character and that arc that he's been on thus far?
I just want to see him having more fun, but also maybe having a dilemma. Who knows?
I think various people have said that the third season was originally conceived as potentially being the last. Is that your understanding as well, or do you think the success of the show might prompt more stories with these characters, more adventures?
It's really difficult to know. I have no idea. I don't think anybody does, apart from Jason Sudeikis, who will be keeping that very close to his chest. But I respect the integrity of keeping that to that arc, that three-season arc. If that's how it is, so be it. You know, we've had, you know, classical series like Fawlty Towers and The Office who've just said, that's enough, this is the story, and left it at that. And they've still reverberated for years afterwards.
I mean, you mentioned Jason there. Fans love him, whatever he does, but there seems to be something just uniquely special about that character. What do you think makes him such a very perfect fit for Ted?
A perfect fit for Ted. Well, I think he's a very warm person, and he's very smart too, and emotionally intelligent. And so he brings a lot of that to the character, and he's smart enough to let you see what's behind the buoyancy of that character and the warmth, and where does it come from? Where does that consistent big heart come from? And the fact is, as we've seen in season two, it comes from a difficult place, and to take that mask away is just such a clever thing to do.
Talking about clever, the show is packed with so many clever and just memorable comedic moments. I'm curious if you have a personal favorite. Obviously fans have their own. Is there one that makes you smile when you think about it?
I think Nate kicking the poo off off the field, it still gets me every time. But you know, great thing about the show, there is great wit, and there's all the comedies. It's got the high comedy and low comedy, and not low comedy, but you know, it's got some physical stuff and some incredibly astute, witty stuff too.
And the occasional jazz beard as well.
The occasional jazz beard.
Are you hoping they bring that back for season three, just full jazz beard?
I don't know. It was a little bit itchy, I have to say. I haven't grown a very good one myself. So.
I think it's looking very distinguished. I like it.
I'm in a film called The Art of Love, which is a strange take on the sex industry. It's written and directed by a Swiss director, and that's been going the rounds at festivals, so we'll see what happens to that.
Before you leave us, is there anything you can tell us more about that one in terms of where you fit into it and why people should make sure they watch it when they get a chance?
I play the husband of the female lead character. We'll see what happens to it, whether it gets distribution and reviews and all that kind of thing.
It's indie films that put the mark and make the difference in terms of storytelling, because you don't rely on other circumstances or other people to be able to tell your story. And I think it's just a passion. I think indie films are driven by passion. Making a film, it's very hard. And just putting it out there, it's a whole process. already preparing an indie film is hard. Making it is hard. And then making it known and post-producing it and available for people, it's even harder. So I think it's festivals like these ones that help the upcoming talent to stand out. And I think I'm very grateful with David Martinez, Elliot Grove for letting me be here tonight. And very grateful for Raindance to exist, because, again, it's what makes the difference between the filmmakers that we have now and the filmmakers that we will have in the future.
One story that fans have a huge passion for is the story of Richmond FC and Ted Lasso. Can you talk about why you think the series has meant so much to so many people?
I mean, it's just a good storytelling with good messages and really knowing what is what you want to tell about. And I mean, working in Ted Lasso has made me realize about the importance and how important it is to really know what message you want to spread out when you tell a story. And of course, given the circumstances and the times we're living, I'm so happy to realize and be part of a project that has meant so much to many people's lives, and it's been great.
Of course, fans cannot wait for you guys to resume production on season 3, possibly the final season, we don't know. I know you guys haven't seen the scripts yet necessarily, but is there anything you're especially hoping to see, not just for your character, but for the family at Richmond FC overall as we enter into season 3?
Well, I honestly trust 100% the creators of the show, Jason, Bill, Brendan, Joe, and all the writers and what they will create. I still don't know what season 3 is going to be. I also don't know if it's the last one. Whatever it will be, it's going to be for the best. I'm just very happy with what season 2 was for me as a person and as a character. And the only thing I can hope is that I'm just looking forward to being with the amazing cast and crew, great people, kind people, and I just hope my character can have more storyline and an arc, which already has. So I'm just grateful to be part of this amazing show surrounded by amazing people.
Do you have a favorite moment on screen and perhaps a favorite moment on set, particularly when you look back on season 2?
My favorite two moments in the show have been when Nick Mohammed, Nate the Great, had that speech at the locker room. So many characters, so many emotions, and there was lots of improv, and I really loved it. And my mainly favorite moment in Ted Lasso was when we had that Sogwarts scene. It was literally all characters of the show in one scene, one room, and it was very special just to see everyone, hang out with everyone. Everyone had a moment, and it's a moment I will always remember.
People love Jason whenever he does anything, but there's something seemingly unique about the bond he has with this character and the way people responded to that. What do you think it is about Jason's performance that makes it so unique, makes it so, I guess, special in terms of his connection to this character specifically?
I mean, it's just, again, it's just what makes this show very special. I think it's about people, regular people. Usually we see people that succeed, and it's all great, and we always love to see that, but we also see vulnerable people, vulnerable characters, people that go through stuff, and I think life is that. It cannot be always very happy moments. It's also sometimes sad, and you can have anger, and all those things that life is what makes it. So I think that's why we connect so well with Ted Lasso and with most of the characters. And also, it's really cool that they really work the characters around who we are as people. So I think that's, and also includes Jason, myself, and all the cast, you know.
Does that mean that in real life, your penalty taking continues to improve?
Yes, I like to think so. I don't kill dogs, though. But yeah, I think life is football. Honestly, life is a game, and sometimes you win, sometimes you lose, sometimes you tie. But you always work hard to improve your game, to improve the way you do it. And I think that's why football is really life.
Hello, my name is Rakie Ayola, and I'm an actor and producer. I always think it's great when we celebrate the work that people do. I know that it's not all about awards, but actually it's nice to be recognised. It's nice to know that your peers appreciate your work. An independent film is important because not everyone has access to the big companies, and they have an idea, they have a script, they have a story they want to tell, they have a passion, and they're able to get on with it. And so when you gather all those people together for a night like this, and everyone can just celebrate the work that they've done, really, it's hugely important. It's quite a privilege being on the jury because it means that people are interested in what you have to say. It means that you've reached a point in your career where people think you might know a thing or two and they want to know your thoughts. And the work that I saw is still with me. The work that I saw hit me in the gut and made me cry, actually. I sobbed through a lot of the work that I saw. It was that affecting. And that's as big a compliment as I can pay it, really, that it hit me hard and it's still with me. And sometimes it made me laugh, and that's great too. But, you know, that as long as it grabs you in some way, it doesn't matter what it is. Even if what it's doing is making you jump out of your seat, you know, it's affecting you, and that's important. It means we're alive, right? As a child, I buried myself in stories. You know, I lived the lives of the Little Women, of the Waltons, of Pollyanna and Anne of Green Gables. So stories were always huge to me. There was never a time when I wasn't living somebody else's life in my head, really. So I get it, and I don't know what the world would be like if we weren't creating. I mean, we've done that since we could communicate, I guess. We've made up stories to entertain each other, to make each other feel better, sometimes to make each other feel sad, to scare each other. Imagination. It's all about using our imagination. It's an important thing. It's been quite a year for me because on top of everything else that we've all been going through, I received Best Supporting Actress BAFTA this year. So it was a big deal professionally. I'm hugely grateful for that. I'm currently shooting Grace, second series for ITV with John Sim. And in December, Alex Rider season 2 will be out, and I'll be in that as well. So I've been very fortunate. It's been a good year professionally.
I guess just starting with Grace, can you tell us a little bit about where season 2 picks up in terms of where we left off in season 1 and how exciting it's been for you to continue that journey, and particularly with John?
Oh, my goodness. Well, if anyone watches... start again. If anyone's a reader of the books by Peter James, then they'll know that they saw the first book in the spring. The second book will also be out, actually, this autumn, our version of the second book. And as that's happening, we're shooting books 3, 4, and 5. Grace, maybe finds love. I suppose that's the big thing, along with solving lots of really gruesome crimes. Peter James has quite a vivid imagination. So the crimes are fairly grim, but Grace is on the case, so I guess it all works out in the end.
I mean, how close is a roadmap? Obviously, you mentioned the books, and it's amazing to have that source material there. How close is a roadmap is the series sticking to it? Because obviously, we've seen other series like Game of Thrones that started off incredibly faithful to the books and then gradually drifted away from them. Can you maybe talk a little bit about that aspect of the show?
I think the series is really faithful to the books, actually. I think the biggest change is that the books were written, I think, in the 80s. So they've had to be slightly updated. But all the characters you would know from the books are there. They come, they go. They have a good time, not so good. But I think Peter's all over it, really. So we haven't swung off. And you will definitely recognize it as the books you've read.
Of course, you mentioned they're joining the cast of Alex Rider for season 2. Can you tell us anything about specifically the role you'll be playing, kind of where you fit into that world? Because it's a fun world to jump into.
Alex Rider was great fun. And I play the deputy director of the CIA, which was so much fun. Had some really beautiful scenes with Stephen Delane and Vicky McClure. That was a fun job, actually, because the stakes are high, but it's kind of... You've got one foot in James Bond territory, so who doesn't love that? You know what I mean? And very nice clothes. Win-win.
so much of this industry is fueled by money, and to get like a real celebration of soul and artistry and heart is like a really magical thing. These people are all here because they absolutely love film and they want to celebrate it and make it, and it's a passion for all of us. But I'm just really excited to get to be surrounded by all of this amazing talent, because yeah, it's really inspiring, especially after like a year and a half of feeling mostly uninspired. To be surrounded by these people is pretty special.
I think during the past couple of years, everyone's been asking themselves big questions, and a common one is why storytelling matters so much in our lives. Can you talk a little bit about what, for you, I know it's a big question, but what it means to be a storyteller?
It's escapism, to be honest. Like, I think, I don't know, for me as an actor, I started out acting because I wanted to get out of my head. I wanted to tell other stories, to live in other people's bodies, and like it is, I think a lot, especially over the last year and a half, we've all been wanting to get out of our heads and out of our lives, and it's been, film is a real place where you get to explore that and cherish that and celebrate it. So a lot more, please.
The last time we spoke to you, we were sort of coming through season two of The Spanish Princess. Looking back on that now, with that having finale and everything, can you talk a little bit about how you feel about particularly that final episode?
Oh, I'm honestly just so sad it's over. If I could go back and do that job again, I would do it in a heartbeat. I loved it so much. And that final episode, like, you know, I think also especially for like for both me and Rory, like we've both taken those characters on such a journey and grown so much as actors and as people, and getting to finish it. And we did it just before the pandemic. It was like, I will never really forget that experience. It was the best job I've ever done. I actually have a couple of films in production. I just wrapped on a feature called The Piper, which is a horror retelling of the Pied Piper of Hamelin. I did that in Bulgaria with Erlingur Þórðarson, who is this amazing Icelandic director who did Rust. I don't know if you know that. He was amazing. And I'm I'm really lucky to be working, but I'm very, very glad to be back on set and back telling stories.
The Chelsea Cowboy, is that another one you're involved with? Can you tell us just a little bit about that one?
I'm doing that at the moment. So, yeah, it's super fun. It's like 60s, 70s in London, and I get to play a battered wife, which is, I mean, kind of my typecasting at the moment. So, you know. I think it's really, really important to get to play women in their late 20s, early 30s who are going through real stuff. Like, there's so much of this industry doesn't really write for those women. Like, it writes young girls or it writes mothers. And there's some terrifying stuff that, like, we go through with infertility, with miscarriage, with the stakes in relationships and marriages breaking down. And those are topics that are really dear to my heart and to a lot of my friends' hearts. So getting to really explore those, I think is really important, but also just really satisfying for me. I think that like the more we get to take ownership over our own stories, the better. Like, as an actor, I spend so much time waiting for my phone to ring and waiting for people to give me permission to tell a story. And I, to be honest, wish I was better at writing, because I wish I could go out and write better stuff for kind of, but I'm trying my hardest to do as much as I can, as best as I can. But if I'm honest, my true passion is acting. I love getting to inhabit other people's visions. So I'm just grateful for any opportunity I get to do that, to be honest.
You mentioned you're not a good writer, but I am curious, if you were writing a third season for The Spanish Princess, if they said to you, right, if you write it, we'll film it, what would you have wanted to put in there? What would you have wanted to see had you got a chance to keep going with that journey?
Vengeance. Yeah. I'd really, really like revenge, where I just strangled Henry and it was a slow, painful, maybe actually a stab. Anything that makes it more fantasy. We also had this kind of, this weird, we really were obsessed with the idea that maybe they could come back in a third season and be vampires, and that be the whole understory, like score of the story, is that actually you think it's Henry VIII and Catherine of Aragon, but really they're vampires. So I would really like to go back and do something really like dark and gruesome and what you wouldn't expect from a period drama.
Studios take note, project under offer.
That's why I'm not a writer.
Why do you think that events like this and independent storytelling matters so very much?
Well, literally, because it's independent, I guess. That's the hope, that people just keep telling stories, whether on a big scale or a small scale. I've never minded. I just want to see good stories and be part of good storytelling. And as an audience, I love it when something comes through that you haven't expected, or people you don't know, people you've never heard of. And I've always loved that, you know. So, it's well worth supporting all that at all times.
Talking about great storytelling, do you mind if I ask about The Responder, the series you've been working on, that I think I've heard you say before is something that was a little unexpected when you read that script?
Yeah, The Responder's going to be out in January, and it's something I'm very proud of. And it's Tony Schumacher has written it, he's a Liverpool writer. And I think it's going to be a bit different, I hope, anyway. Yeah, but that was, again, yeah, the power of writing. That always gets me in. I'm a sucker for a good script. And I'll crawl over broken glass for a good story and a well-told character, so yeah.
Tell us just a little bit more about the character, obviously, for people who haven't been lucky enough to see the show yet, just what it was that made you think that he was someone that you'd have a lot of fun, a lot of interest in diving into.
Oi, oi, oi. I mean, well, he's a complex character. He's not a goodie, he's not a baddie, he's a complex character, and you know, he's a copper doing night work, and it's a hard job. It's a hard job, and I've got a lot of empathy for the people who do that job, and this guy is going through a lot of stuff, and as you see, it's why I'm not in advertising, I'm in acting, because I can't sell a script to save my life. You have to wait till January.
Well, you're in it, so already sold. We're here tonight at the Raindance Film Festival, obviously celebrating the power of storytellers. Can you tell us a little bit about, for you, what made Chadwick such a very special and important storyteller?
Well, I truly loved working with Chadwick, and not only on, you know, not only on camera, but just his company was great. He was humble, he was committed, he was focused, and he was really, really dedicated to what he did. So much so, of course, that nobody knew he was ill. He didn't want anybody to know he was ill, because he didn't want to have people to change people's perception of him. And that made it all the more shocking, of course, when he died. But I can only, you know, for my little bit that I had with him, I absolutely adored working with him. And he was a truly, he was a good man, you know. And you can't say that about all of us, you know.
Fans were initially questioning with Black Panther and that franchise how it would continue. But I think there was a general consensus that it was important, particularly for Chadwick, that story did continue, that his legacy was kind of continued on screen. Are you still involved with that going forward? And can you talk a little bit about how you feel about how the franchise is going to continue in a respectful way without, obviously, Chadwick's immeasurable presence in it?
Yeah, I'm still in it. I've just done the second Black Panther, yeah. So on it goes. And, of course, it goes, you know, not just for Chadwick, but for the world of that, and for the fans, the millions and millions of people who want to see it all over the world. And, yeah, it's definitely something that everyone is mindful of doing it. I mean, everyone wants to make a good film anyway, but certainly you don't want to do something that doesn't respect what that story is anyway and doesn't respect his legacy. So, yeah, it's going to be done with the utmost, and it is being done with the utmost commitment, as always, yeah. It's kind of odd because it's a big hole. It's a very, very big hole. But at the same time, as you know, as much as Chadwick was at the heart of it, he wasn't the only thing about it. Do you know what I mean? He was a very, very big hole at the middle of it. But, you know, there are scores and scores of people working in a dedicated way to carry on making that story, you know, and those stories. So it was odd. It was odd, but it was very loving and respectful at the same time, you know. His presence is always going to be there, and it's always on set, and it's always kind of... Yeah, it's in the ether, you know, when you're on set there, this gaping hole. But at the same time, it goes on. It has to go on. So, yeah.